Hello everyone. So my talk is toward the end of the day, but I think you guys are still awake and keen to know what goes underneath the VR, what are the underlying technology, and how does VR essentially work. And I believe many of you would, so can I know how many of you are VR developers that develop something in VR? Okay, so what do you guys use? Unity and Unreal. So Unity and Unreal encapsulate a lot of underlying technology and you're not exposed to it. For example, you may not know how does stereoscopic rendering work in VR, or how does the distortion correction happen in VR, or how does chromatic aberration correction in VR. What does the game engines or the VR SDKs do to make sure that VR keeps on rendering at least 90 FPS in case of PC VR and 60 FPS in case of mobile VR. So we'll go through these underlying concepts, and if you guys have any question in the middle of the talk, you can just stop me and ask the question. So a little bit about me, I'm working as a VP of R&D at SmartvizX. I have worked for Intel's RealSense team in Santa Clara, led the Gear VR team at Samsung R&D, 16 years in the graphics and VR industry, have an MS in VR from Iowa State and a BTech from IIT Kanpur, and one of the cricketer, musician, theater artist. So the outline of the talk will be on the lines of, I'll first give an introduction of what VR is, which I'll do very fast because I believe the audience here is pretty aware of what VR actually is. And we'll go into see things, what makes VR so compelling, what are the challenges with VR, solutions and techniques, advanced techniques in VR, and future research areas. So you guys may be familiar with this VR-AR continuum. So this is a continuum between a real environment, which can be a tangible user interface, or it can be, on the other extreme, is a virtual environment, which is virtual reality. And in between, we have augmented reality, which is closer to reality with some augmented virtuality on top of it. And then augmented virtuality, which is virtual information or virtual world, augmented with some real information. So why VR? I mean, anybody wants to answer what makes VR so compelling? Like, you can still do things on a two-dimensional PC screen, right? What makes VR so compelling? Why do we have to, why so much noise about VR now? I mean, whatever you see in VR, you can see the same thing, for example, a game or any virtual walkthrough. You can still see in a 2D, two-dimensional computer monitor. So what makes VR so compelling? Any ideas? Yeah, so that's called immersion or presence. This is the closest we have come to what I call teleportation. I mean, there has been sci-fi movie about where people will teleport themselves from one place to another place, but in VR you can actually do that. And it is very, very easy to get started. All you need to do is pick up a Unity or Unreal game engine and download the Steam VR SDK or Oculus SDK and start writing your own VR application or VR game. So this is called Gartner Hype Cycle for Emerging Technologies. So you can see this part where the upward curve is called innovation trigger, where most of the early stage technology are in this space. VR was in this curve maybe 20 years back. And then comes the few of the common technologies that are in this phase is the volumetric and holographic displays, or 3D bioprinting systems, or smart robots. Then comes the what you call peak of inflated expectation. So that's where is the technology is at its most hype, and so we have things like Internet of Things, natural language question answering, wearable user interfaces, these are at the peak of their expectation. And then comes the trough of disillusionment, where the hype goes down about the technology, and you know, people start coming to reality about the technology, and then comes the slope of enlightenment, where people start building useful use cases using the technology. So you guys can see augmented reality is still a little bit behind VR in terms of where it is. So that is still in trough of disillusionment because there has been no killer AR use cases. Number one, there has been no killer AR hardware other than maybe Microsoft HoloLens, which is still with the it's a very, very inferior form of AR than what AR actually means for people. VR has started to go up in the slope of enlightenment. So that's where VR is becoming mainstream. Consumer VR is getting common, and you know, VR is getting cheaper and affordable. And there are more and more use cases of VR, non-gaming use cases of VR that are coming up. And industry players have reacted to VR. Everybody has jumped onto Sony, Samsung, HTC has jumped onto hardware. And Facebook is making Oculus platform. Google is making Google Daydream platform. And there are media companies who are going into VR, and then they have brands or enterprise companies. So what are the enterprise use cases of VR? Entertainment has been the number one, which are movies and gaming. And then real estate, that's where companies like SmartvizX come into picture, where they see VR as a medium of display where people can actually experience or walk through of the unbuilt properties or without actually going to the properties. And then there's engineering and automobile. Education space is coming up big time with respect to VR, where educational content can be conveyed to potential users in the through the medium of VR. Retail and fashion is coming up, and healthcare, of course. So these are all the major use cases. Cinema, you have, I can't go through all of them, but you know, the major ones are cinema, which Jaunt VR is one of the main companies in that area. And then, you know, Marriott has a VR experience center for their hotels. Architecture, SmartVizX is doing a lot of good work. I mean, we are building things that will enable people to start designing in VR or developing your own virtual walkthrough of spaces. Education is there, surgery training. I mean, so what Zach Cantor said was people will spend the majority of waking time in virtual reality by 2020. And we are seeing that VR is going in that direction. Quickly go to the VR market size that is projected for year 2025. So video games is still the major one. Then come the live events, video entertainment, retail, real estate is a big area, education, healthcare is a very big area, and engineering. So VR is supposed to be, AR VR combined is supposed to be $150 billion market in next 5 years. So quickly go through what we do. So we are SmartvizX is a VR company, and we focus primarily on real estate sector right now, where we are building technology which can enable people to create a virtual walkthrough of pre-built spaces and you know, interact with the spaces. So we have a couple of products out there. VIVIT is the web-based product, and ArcViz is the PC VR-based product. That we are making some news. I'll quickly go over it. Okay, coming back to VR. So there are two forms of VR that were, you know, conceptualized when VR was becoming mainstream. One was HMD, which has become very mainstream right now, Oculus Rift and HTC Vive. And the other is what is called cave. So how many of you know what cave is? Okay, good. So cave used to be, before HMD became popular, cave used to be one of the most important hardware setup that can display VR information. So what it is basically six-sided or four-sided cube in which all the screens are projected, and all the screens have stereoscopic projection. And when user steps into it and wears some kind of VR glasses, like shutter glasses, he can feel that he's actually inside that space. So when I was working at Iowa State University way back in 2002, we were working in cave at that time, and cave, in fact, my major professor happened to be the inventor of cave. So what makes VR so real? Let's see that. Basically, one, two very funny incidents where people step into the VR, and one guy is doing some kind of a wall climbing in VR, and he becomes so involved and starts imagining he's actually doing a wall climbing that he goes to hold a wall which is not there in real life and he falls down. And other video was one guy was on the roller coaster and somebody pushes him from behind, and he starts feeling he's actually there in roller coaster and totally freaks out. So, but the bottom line is, it shows that so it shows that there's something convincing about VR, which is making it, you know, almost making the people believe that they are in that virtual environment. And that phenomenon is called presence. So there are definitions of presence out there on net, but this is what I have come up. VR is all about fooling the brain and all its sensory perception to start believing that it is actually present in the virtual environment. So how does VR become so believable? Because of presence that I just talked about, and you feel presence because of immersion. In a 2D screen, when you see something on 2D screen, you see the same information, but you don't feel immersed in that. When you are in VR, you are immersed in that virtual environment. Perception. So that immersion changes the perception about how you perceive things. When you are immersed and perceiving things, your brain starts feeling that you're already there. And interaction. And if you can start interacting with virtual environment through touch or through gesture or through a beta glove, then all the three, immersion, perception, and interaction, combine to give you a feeling of presence. So VR is not easy. A lot of underlying challenges. I mean, Unity and Unreal make VR very easy to develop, which is good for us as developers. But what has gone underneath with the kinds of, you know, Michael Abrashes of Oculus or John Carmack of Oculus, what they have done internally is they have done a lot of good work underneath the surface that makes VR development so easy, and that's what makes VR technology so convincing. So immersive virtual reality has extreme requirements. You have to have very high visual quality, which will be there if you have extreme pixel quantity and quality. You need to have surround sound quality, and there's a concept of 3D audio, because sometimes we get the cue of how far some object is or which direction the object is based on our auditory senses, how we are hearing the sound that is coming from those objects. That gives us a perception of depth and position. So that's what is required in VR also, to feel more immersive in VR. And intuitive interaction. You know, you need to have some interaction which has minimum latency. I mean, a game runs on a PC runs at 24 FPS. So that gives sufficient time, around 50 milliseconds, for each frame to render. And whenever you do some action, it has sufficient time for it to update. In VR, it's only 16 milliseconds for each eye. That means 8 milliseconds for one eye. So that is the time required in which interaction and display the entire cycle has to come through. So how to achieve total immersion? Total immersion is achieved by enabling or improving few basic technologies about display. First is depth perception. I mean, when we see something on a PC screen, you see it as an image, but you don't perceive the depth. Everything is on the same screen. So what VR lets you do is it lets you do perceive the depth of the object in VR space. Field of view. So anybody knows what is the field of view of human eye? Sorry? So it's little more than 180. I mean, I can see that side also, I can see that side also. That's a pretty big field of view. To be able to do that in VR, we are not there yet. HTC Vive and Oculus Rift have 110 FOV. Gear VR has 90 FOV. So we are not there yet. I mean, when I say 120 FOV, we are talking about only this space. This space is all still black to me. So these will improve as technology improves, and that will give more and more immersion. Then high FPS and refresh rate. So our eyes, our brain perceives things if they are more than, if they are, perceives information if it is more than 60 frames per second. So if something is happening more than 60 frames per second, then our brain will not be able to see the difference between individual frames. I mean, it will not see the previous frame growing back and the next frame coming in. So that's why VR requirement is that the frame per second should be at least 60 FPS. But people are now trying for 120 FPS because that will, according to John Carmack, that gives more, better, you know, better immersion inside VR. And also the refresh rate. There is something called persistence in the screen. So when one frame goes away and the next frame comes in, there's a persistence of the previous frame. That's called ghosting effect also, you would have seen sometimes when in movies, you know, between two frames. So that also has to improve. Low persistence I just talked about. And high resolution. So when we see a VR, I'll talk more detail later. So when we see a VR, the display is still 7 inches approximately, 6 to 7 inches. And they are very close to our eye. So when those many pixels so close to our eye, we will see individual pixels. Unless we have a very, very high resolution. The ideal resolution for VR, you have a question? The ideal resolution for VR headset is 8K and 8K for each eye. We are nowhere close to that right now. But again, next 4 or 5 years, the research is going on, and that thing, those techniques also will improve. And low latency. Latency is the moment, the difference in time when you do some action and the scene incorporates that action and renders the frame, and that frame appears on the screen and you see it through lenses. This entire cycle is called latency, and if the latency is big or large, then you will see the, you'll feel things like feeling dizzy in VR environment. So that's what people say, that they, a lot of people say that they feel motion sickness inside VR environment, and that's because the latency is still there, not fully solved yet.